for nearly 300 years, and despite having a perfectly good front door, the only way into this beautiful 15th century chapel was through a hole in the roof. I'll tell you why in just a moment and where I am. Today, I'm with a South London couple who have big business plans for their move to the country. But are their property expectations realistic when it comes to budget?
At the moment, £50 change.
Yeah.
That's all I could give you.
Get enough for lunch.
A nice lunch.
Yeah, good one. 50, yeah.
However, our houses definitely give them a new perspective.
Each one is a snapshot into the garden.
Yes.
Yes, yeah.
It's like having big pictures on the wall.
Today I'm in Cornwall, and this is the Chapel of St Enadoc, which, from the 16th century through to the mid-1800s, was almost completely buried in sand that had blown in from the nearby dunes. Now, to maintain its status, the chapel had to host at least one service every year. So the vicar and congregation would have been lowered in through a hole in the roof. Happily, in 1864, St Enadoc was finally dug out of its sandy tomb, and visitors have been able to use the front door ever since. Lying in the extreme southwestern sleeve of England, the county of Cornwall shares an eastern land border with Devon, but is otherwise surrounded by the sea, with the Atlantic Ocean to its north and the English Channel to the south. Almost a third of the county is designated as an area of outstanding natural beauty. Historically, Cornwall was famed for its tin mines, but these fell into decline in the mid-19th century. Today, the imposing ruins of this once booming industry lie scattered across the county. Cornwall's only city is Truro. Its Gothic Revival Cathedral took 30 years to build and opened in 1910. During mining's heyday, the city prospered, and the industry's legacy is still evident in its elegant architecture and monuments. Cornwall's rugged north coast faces the Atlantic, making it a paradise for surfers. Polzeath Beach is popular both with those hoping to catch a wave and more sedate holidaymakers. The tiny fishing village of Mousel, 3 miles west of Penzance, has a charming harbour surrounded by twisting streets and lichen-covered houses. For those who want to appreciate the local crafts and produce, walk along the wild coastal paths, or simply soak up the unspoiled beauty of one of England's most distinctive counties, Cornwall offers an appealing escape option for both holidaymakers and those seeking a permanent move.
There's no denying that Cornwall is one of the most popular counties in the country to own a second home or holiday let. In some coastal and rural areas, as much as 42% of the homes aren't lived in by what's called usual residents. That means they're not permanently occupied by the same person. So, as you can imagine, that can push property prices up. But don't worry, because the average cost of a detached Cornish home here at the moment is £309,000. That's £22,000 below the national figure. So, great value homes in a super county. All we need to do now is find a couple who want to permanently move here.
Hannah and her IT consultant husband Robin tied the knot over 20 years ago and have 2 adult children.
Yeah, we met in about 93, 94. Mm. We met through mutual friends. We've been together ever since, really.
Yes, after about 3-4 years. Now, how to get married?
She's very good with the children, a very good cook, very creative at making the garden look nice, which unfortunately gives me a lot of work, but never mind.
Though Britain has been Hannah's home for decades, her early roots lie elsewhere.
I was born in Vietnam and came here in 1983. So now we are nearly retirement time. So I think this is the time we need to change.
They currently live in Robin's birthplace, Croydon, a town in the South London suburbs.
The area's changed massively since I was born. Every time you turn around, there's another building gone up, and the traffic just seems to get worse day by day.
Cornwall has previously been a holiday retreat for Robin and Hannah, and their move to the country gives them a chance to get outdoors and let their dogs off the leash.
Yeah, we enjoy walking. We'd like to be able to do that in the countryside. Here, we just really walk around the block to take the dogs out. It's not quite the same thing.
Our dog and our cat is very important to us.
Hannah hopes to rekindle a lifelong passion for painting, while Robin will be refocusing on his past love of photography.
I'd like to take up photography again. Being based in Cornwall would be an ideal, because I do primarily landscape or flower photography, so that would be perfect.
Although they'll be leaving their busy London life behind them, they hope a move to the country will kickstart a new business venture.
Ideally, the house should have an annex. Would be useful, two aspects, running as a holiday let during the warmer months. And obviously, if family want to come down, they've got somewhere to stay.
We hope that in a couple of years, we have a lovely house and nice big garden, so grandchildren will come back to visit us and have more room for them to run around.
Robin and Hannah won't be travelling back to London frequently, but their family will be visiting, so North Cornwall is their ideal location. They have other requirements for their property, so I want to meet them and find out the finer details of their wish list.
Well, Hannah and Robin, welcome to Cornwall. So tell me, what are you looking for with this move? What type of property?
Well, we like the sort of stone-built properties. Interior, perhaps, a little bit modernised, opened up. Edge of village would be ideal, so it's not too many neighbours.
This annex, you want to rent it out as a holiday let,
yes,
I believe?
Yes, yeah, because we're more away from the city, so we're looking to, you know, a little bit for income when we live out there, when we retire.
And Hannah, let's talk about this garden, because you're a passionate gardener, aren't you? A little bit like me. Is an acre going to be enough for you? It's quite a lot to look after.
Not enough.
Is it not?
Not enough. Yeah, I have a lot in mind.
Who is going to make the final decision, do you think? Robin didn't even have to open his lips.
I put my hand first.
Did you?
Oh, yeah,
he says the same.
We compromise.
Yeah, you compromise, do you? But you're going to make the final decision. Fair enough. Now, remind us how much we've got to spend with this move.
The maximum is £450,000.
That's if we find the perfect home, £450,000.
Ticked all the boxes, yes.
How many bedrooms? We didn't discuss this.
About three bedrooms.
Two to three, yeah.
Do you think we're being realistic with that budget, in your opinion?
If you're on the edge of a village, I think you've got more chance at that sort of
And
budget.
We trust you. You do well.
You trust me? Yeah. I'm feeling the pressure, Hannah. I'm feeling the pressure. Well, we do have some rather wonderful homes already lined up to show you. If you want to follow me, let's get started.
Okay.
Thank you.
With a maximum budget of £450,000, Hannah and Robin would like a 2 to 3 bedroom property so that family can visit. The house should be on the edge of a village, be light and airy inside, but have a character exterior and ideally be built of stone. Hannah wants the garden to be an acre or more and preferably come with an annex that can be used for holiday lets. I've got a wide range of attractive houses to show them both, and I'll be asking them to guess the price of each one before I reveal it to them. The final proposition will be the mystery house, which offers an unpredictable twist on their requirements. It's a conversion that I hope will make their spirits soar.
What do your children think about you moving to the country?
They are a little bit worried too far away, but they know that Devon or Cornwall is, you know, a lovely place for retirement.
And do you manage to go back to Vietnam much?
Yes, not every year, because very far away.
It is,
But every time we go back to Vietnam, I always pack some English tea.
Do you?
Yeah.
You miss your brew, do you?
Yes, yeah.
We're starting our house hunting journey in the village of North Pethewin, in the northeast of the county. Originally in Devon, North Pethewin became part of Cornwall in 1966. It's home to a beautiful stone church dating back to Norman times, along with a primary school and a local pub situated around a mile away. It's also the base for the Tamar Otter and Wildlife Centre, which helps conserve the Cornish otter population. Set in beautiful natural surroundings of its own is house number one.
See, I've brought you through the scenic route to our first property because this garden is so beautiful. And here
colourful,
is,
yeah,
hopefully, our first home.
Yeah, lovely. Yeah, certainly
beautiful.
Stunning.
Unusual?
Yes.
Yes, yeah.
First impressions?
Yeah, yeah, lovely.
Got some character.
Yeah. I love the garden.
Shall we start?
Why not?
Yeah.
The house was converted in 1993 from what is thought to have been an 18th century granary. Once inside, a left turn leads to the open-plan kitchen dining area.
So you've got a really long hallway here, and at the end of it is the kitchen.
Lovely kitchen.
It's got the dining area as well.
Yeah, I think enough space for us.
Yeah.
They've opened it up. You can see you've got your range
which is what
there.
We like. Yes.
Mm. So, you know, would you change anything?
We'd probably decorate it to lighten it up a bit. Mm. It's perhaps a little dark for our taste, but that's just cosmetic. It's minor.
It's a rather strong start to this house tour. That's very good.
To the right of the kitchen, a utility room provides more convenient storage space and possibly a room Hannah and Robin could give over to the dogs. Next, we're moving into the charming sitting room where light streams in from every angle.
This is where the granary part of the process would have happened.
The beams are nice as well. They're not too dominant.
Not low.
Yeah, it's quite high ceiling as well.
Do you like the idea, though, of having all these doors and windows?
I love it, yeah.
Each one is a snapshot into the garden.
Yes.
Yes.
It's like having big pictures on the wall.
Yeah. Very true. It's an interesting property because from the outside, it looks like it's all one level, but there is an upstairs with two bedrooms. Mm-hmm. I'm going to show you the one that's down here, the master. Thank you.
We're retracing our steps down the long hallway to see if this ground floor master bedroom measures up.
I would say this is probably the largest in a way of the three bedrooms because it takes a double bed.
Got some built-in storage by the looks of things.
Built-in storage and a little cloakroom in there as well with a family bathroom next door.
I see.
So how do we feel about what you've seen in this part of the property so far?
Yeah, so far so good and very solidly built.
In addition to the master, the house has two cosy bedrooms tucked away upstairs in the eaves, as well as an ample attic for storage.
There's also the business arrangement to consider. Yeah. So, Robin, if you wouldn't mind popping back out through the front door, let's have a look at next door and see what's there.
A dividing wall ensures complete privacy from the adjoining annex, which Hannah and Robin could rent out.
So next door, you have your holiday let.
Oh, that's a lovely
room.
Yeah, good size.
At the moment, they make about £8,000 a year.
Right.
But that's only really for the spring and summer months.
Yes, yeah.
That's reasonable, yeah.
Have you ever done anything like this before?
No.
Oh, the hospitality. It's big business in Cornwall, isn't it?
And with a well-appointed kitchen, two bedrooms and a generous-sized bathroom, this annex can comfortably accommodate a family of four.
Shall we head out into the garden? Still more to show you. And then, of course, we're going to have to discuss how much you think this property's on the market for.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
A fenced-off garden for the annex means that Robin and Hannah will be undisturbed by guests, while an ample driveway allows parking for several cars. The beautifully designed garden covers a third of an acre and features acers, providing that oriental feel, along with landscaped rockeries. Keen cook Hannah could also make use of the greenhouse on the rear patio.
This really is the most delightful garden.
I see the garden is beautiful, but I need more.
You need a bit more
I need
space.
More space for my grandchildren in the future to play football.
Okay. Yeah. What do you think our converted barn is on the market for?
Could be about £380,000.
£380,000. Okay.
Because of the size of the annex, I'm going to say £415,000.
Well, we have taken you right to the top of your budget with this property. The asking price is £449,950. So at the moment, £50 change.
Yeah.
That's all I could give you.
Good enough for lunch.
A nice lunch.
Yeah, good lunch.
I like your attitude. That's good. I'd love you two to go and have a wander around on your own this time.
Okay.
And I'll catch up with you when you're ready.
Okay.
Be my guest.
Yeah. Priced at the top of their budget, this granary conversion has perhaps been a reality check for Robin and Hannah's wish list. That said, it provides a generous stone-built period home, along with an up-and-running holiday let and a third of an acre of landscape gardens.
Careful.
It's quite different up here. It's a little bit more cramped.
It could be hit my head every day.
Perhaps we wouldn't use this bit so much because quite a lot of room downstairs. So this could be more for family and visitors in general.
Well, I think this is a very good start off just for the first property. Not quite there.
I agree, yeah. I think the house is very lovely, but I don't think that is suitable for me and Robin and grandchildren in the future.
All right, well, I think a very good beginning to our house hunt. Let's see how we get on with our next property.
Indeed.
Okay.
Cornwall's coastline stretches for over 400 miles and is a key attraction for nearly 20 million visitors to the county each year. Artist Kirsty Elson uses reclaimed driftwood found on beaches to create miniatures that reflect the beauty of the Cornish coast. Hannah is keen to renew her artistic interests when she moves to Cornwall, so we've sent her and Robin to meet with Kirsty on a beach which inspires her work just outside the small coastal town of Loo.
So, Kirsty, how long you have been doing your artwork for?
I went to art college a long time ago and didn't really do anything with it. Started a family, moved down to Cornwall, and I started collecting things from the beach. I was inspired and it all went from there.
So all of your materials are reclaimed. What's the reason behind that?
I think it's quite authentic when you take materials from the beach and then use it to create something coastal from it.
So what are you looking for when you walk along the beach?
I tend to go with an open mind. I'm not looking for anything specific. I think when you're working with driftwood, each piece is unique, so you never make the same thing twice, and it keeps you creative, definitely.
Once she's collected her driftwood, Kirsty takes it home to dry. It's then cut and shaped before being painted. She's invited Hannah and Robin back to her studio to see how her works come together.
We've got some sort of blocks and then some roof-shaped ones, and I thought we might have a go at making a house together.
Hi, so where did that idea come from?
The first one I made, I found a block and it was house-shaped. It had a slanting roof and it just came to me. I came home and put a bit of slate on for the roof and secured it with a couple of nails that served as chimneys as well.
So do you work from memory, from photographs, or how does it work?
They're not really based on anywhere specific, although I might take inspiration from several places. I don't work from photographs at all. So we've been to the beach. Hopefully you've been inspired. I've got some treasure here for you. Have a play. I'm going to go and put the kettle on, see what you can come up with.
Okay, thank you.
After hearing how Kirsty makes her charming coastal artworks, it's time for Hannah and Robin to see if Cornwall will stimulate their inner creativity.
So, Robin, what do you want to make?
Well, the blocks lend themselves to house shapes. The roof piece doesn't need painting. It's also a nice texture already.
Do you like this colour?
Yeah, it's a sort of stone
colour.
That's
right, yeah. This work is really, really lovely. This remind me about, you know, Japanese, Vietnamese or Chinese art. They often use natural material, yes. I love if I move to the country in Cornwall, I could be try to create something like this. What do you think, Robbie?
Yes, looks like a house, kind of cottage.
How have you guys got on? Do you have fun?
Yes.
Oh, no, you've got your own little village. Yeah. Hopefully you'll find something bigger than that when you move to Cornwall.
Yeah, thank you.
Our property search continues in the village of Ashwater, just over the Cornish county border into Devon. The village of Howell Junction is 3.5 miles away and offers a shop along with other local amenities. It developed around an important railway interchange. Though the station and the rail routes that served it closed in 1963, its memory endures in the name of the local pub. Back in Ashwater, I've got high hopes for this attractive stone property, an exterior look I know they will love.
I don't know whether you noticed, but we've actually crossed the border, but we've brought you here to show you this next property.
Lovely.
Bobby's spot, it is a converted barn.
Oh, really?
But if I can just bring your eye to this building here, because this is the holiday let.
Look lovely.
Yes,
yeah.
Oh, flying.
Yeah.
So shall we start with the main house or the holiday let? What do you think, Robin?
Why don't we go start with the holiday let?
Excellent. Yeah. Edit. Come on.
An income stream is clearly a priority, so I hope it delivers.
Right, well, here is the holiday let accommodation.
Yes, it looks lovely, very cosy. Yeah, and a lot of character. Yeah.
No need to change anything in here.
So you've got your wood burner. It's a good kitchen, actually. It's not huge, but it's big enough.
Yeah.
Courtyard leading outside, so they have their own private space, and so do you. Mezzanine floor upstairs, which would easily get a double bed. In actual fact, you've got a bedroom down there and a family bathroom.
Mm.
So we like this?
Yeah.
Let's see what you make of your property.
Hannah and Robin seem happy with the substantial holiday let, and I'm hoping they feel the same way about the barn conversion. It dates from the early 1820s and was converted around 25 years ago.
So let's start off in our sitting room.
It's small, but it's nice. Yeah,
nice fireplace.
I like the fireplace.
So you're right, it isn't huge. Mm. Because from the outside, the house looks rather large, doesn't it?
Yes, yeah.
So I think I'm going to have to manage your expectations downstairs, perhaps. Let's try the kitchen.
Slightly muted responses, so I hope the kitchen diner on the other side of the hall gets better reactions.
Let's continue through into our kitchen. Stroke dining room, more of an L-shaped, actually, than a square, because you've actually got a utility room there with a downstairs cloakroom and access outside.
Right. I like the window.
You like the leaded glass, do you?
Yes, yeah. But it's slightly small for us, isn't it?
Yeah. Possibly, yeah.
Yeah, small for us.
Could certainly do a little bit of brightening up.
But it's not blowing you away, is it? Come on, I know you're being polite. Okay. Let's see how we get on upstairs.
On the first floor, there are a total of 3 spacious bedrooms, one of which is currently used for storage, as well as a family bathroom. But we're heading to the third one for them to consider.
I'm going to call this the master bedroom, really mainly because of the views.
So again, we've got the beams over the windows.
Yeah.
I think it looks cosy, it looks nice.
Yeah.
We have really big bed.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
Super king, yeah.
So super king in here, really not much room for anything else.
Yeah.
This is only a personal thought, but I would transform one of those bedrooms into a dressing room and then have another one as the guest at the end.
Dry.
But, you know, it does, I think, need a bit of tweaking. Well, we'll head outside, take a look at some of those views, and then obviously we're going to talk money too.
Yeah.
Robin, if you wouldn't mind leading us back out, thank you.
The house is set in generous gardens and has a secluded rear patio. If they wanted more, there's the option of buying 2.5 extra acres with stables, just a short walk from the property.
Are we going to be under, on, or over your budget?
I'm thinking it might have sneaked slightly over, 460.
I think it could be £435,000.
The asking price for everything is £475,000.
Right, yeah.
Okay. Now, the owner is aware of your budget and is happy to have a conversation for anything over £450,000.
All right, yeah.
So can I add something into the mix here?
Yeah.
If you wanted to buy the acreage separately, it would be sold for £40,000.
Oh.
So if you didn't want it, you could actually buy the house for £435,000.
I see. So with our land.
Yeah, it does add an awful lot on. It makes you think, what actually is it you want with this move? So have another look around.
OK,
and, yeah. And, yeah, if you've got any questions, ask me at the end.
All right. Okay,
thank you.
It is really interesting because, you know, that land isn't attached to the house, but having a price tag of £40,000, it really puts things into perspective for me that do they really need 3 acres of land? Or is it what they want is a large garden, a beautiful home with a holiday let on the side?
Priced at £15,000 under their budget, this 5-bedroom stone barn conversion delivers generously and leaves the money to add their decorative mark to the kitchen diner. The impressive self-contained annex fulfills the brief on their holiday let aspirations. It also comes with extensive gardens. However, if they wanted an extra 2.5 acres, it's possible to purchase for a further £40,000.
The house is nice when you come inside. It's quite homely feeling. Perhaps a bit more compact than you'd think from looking outside the house.
I can see myself can live in thick property. However, I have big family in the future, and I see that quite a little bit small for us.
Yeah, I think today has taught us a lot about the market, and it's particularly on was perhaps higher than we anticipated when we started our search.
I'm not sure if we've entirely cracked this house hunt yet, but I think we're getting close. And of course, I've got something else lined up to show you tomorrow.
Sounds interesting.
Should we hit the road?
Yes.
Why not?
It's the second day of our house search in Cornwall with Croydon couple Robin and Hannah. So far, it's been quite a challenge to meet their property expectations on their £450,000 budget. Coming up, our mystery house is stylish and functional.
Practical?
Yeah, for outdoors.
Yeah, we can bring them in this way. This is easy to clean, the old muddy paw prints.
Definitely.
And my heart is stolen by some new arrivals.
Oh,
they are so adorable.
Although Robin and Hannah have a good budget for this move to Cornwall, they're also asking a lot from it too. In theory, not one but two homes, if you include the holiday let, and a few acres of land. Now, we managed to show them exactly that yesterday, but sadly, neither house really hit the spot. Today, we're going to show them a property with additional income. We've got the land, but it is lacking in space. However, it has two magic words attached to it, planning permission. So let's see if the mystery house can really deliver.
Our mystery property takes us to the village of Lawitton, 2 miles away from the market town of Launceston. The parish church features various periods of English Gothic architecture. It dates from the 13th century, but was restored in the 19th. The village lies just across the border from Devon, and the mystery house could be seen from the River Tamar, tucked away in a glorious woodland setting.
Right, our final property, can I reveal the mystery house?
Certainly got some character,
Really nice, in the middle of the setting.
Well, this actually is a converted chapel, so not a barn today. The chapel was built around 1850 for the local tin miners. Converted in the 1980s, but to me it looks like a proper Cornish home.
Yeah, it looks more like a house.
Now, as it is the mystery house, there's always a curved ball around, isn't there? At the moment, you could live in it, it's absolutely fine, but it might not necessarily have the space that you're seeking. Next door, you've got a garage, as you can see. Planning permission has already been granted, so you've got 3 years left on that to extend, to go up. So you could actually build and have a double bedroom up there, should you want it.
Quite substantial, then, if you did all that.
Absolutely. So should we start our final tour?
Can't wait.
Why not?
Although the mystery house has a traditional stone exterior, the interior has been tastefully reconfigured for modern country living.
So from the front door you've got a hallway.
Yeah.
Which leads us into the sitting room.
I like the floor. I like the...
That's probably original,
I would say. You think that? Yeah.
What about it being open plan? How do you feel about that?
Perfect.
Yeah.
Can you see the
dining area?
Unusual door there, and that would have been the back door to the chapel. We believe that's the original.
Lovely.
Leads out into a courtyard. My thinking would be if you were going to extend into the garage next door, rather than going through the kitchen, you could actually use that as the access point.
Oh.
Put a link tunnel across, into there.
I think look, really very good kitchen.
It's such an important room in the house, I feel.
Certainly light and bright. Nice to see the white units instead of dark wood again.
So with you on that.
The colour, I like it. The colour of the unit and the floor colour, it go together.
Practical?
Yeah, for outdoors.
Yeah, we could bring them in this way. This is easy to clean, you know, muddy paw prints.
Definitely. So you wouldn't change anything then, Robin, in this kitchen?
Not in this kitchen, no. No need to.
Good. That's always a great start. Right, let's see what we make of upstairs.
A doorway leads from the sitting room to a downstairs family bathroom. Then stairs give access to two guest bedrooms up on the first floor, as well as the master bedroom.
Just mind your head as you come in.
Yeah.
The good news is when you get to the bedroom, you can stand up straight.
Yes, look lovely.
Beams. Yeah.
I probably don't like, you know, the beam in the bedroom, but this look really, really nice.
Next door to this is a good size single. Right. However, Robin, just give that a knock.
Stud wall.
Absolutely. Take that down, and I think it would transform the upstairs. Do you like that idea?
Yeah, good idea.
Very good.
Yeah.
Because there's one thing we haven't discussed as yet. What could that be?
The holiday let, perhaps?
The holiday let, yes. There is a lodge. It's hidden, actually, amongst the trees.
Oh.
I guess you'd like to take a look.
Yes, indeed.
All right, yeah.
Let's head outside. Thank you.
That'd be a surprise.
I'm hoping the potential to develop the mystery house means Hannah and Robin won't be put off by its smaller size. Its detached timber holiday let lies up a private pathway. It has a sitting room with a wood-burning stove, a contemporary kitchen dining area overlooking the garden, along with two cosy double bedrooms and a stylish modern bathroom. It would provide them with an up-and-running income stream.
So this is the final part of the jigsaw, the business side. The holiday lodge currently earns around £7,000 a year.
OK.
Now, if you follow this path around,
there
is a second lodge. Current owners use it as a dog grooming business.
Mm.
It's got water, it's got electricity, so it could be a workshop, it could be an office.
Very good.
And then we have the grounds. This obsession you've got with wanting acres and acres. I don't think Robin's ever asked me for lots of garden, but Anna, you definitely have.
Yeah.
Now, it's landscaped at the moment and it's terraced. Right. You've got over an acre here. I mean, it is incredible woodland, but it isn't an orchard.
Yeah.
And it's not a football pitch.
All right. Yeah.
But you could do something very creative, couldn't you, with that area?
Yeah. I can see that, yeah.
We've now got to try and put a price on everything. What do we think this house is on the market for?
I would think slightly over budget, £470,000.
I would like to go to £450,000,
which is the top of your budget.
Yeah.
The asking price is for offers over £450,000.
Right.
What does that say to you, that price? Does it make it appealing?
It does, for what you get.
Yes, yeah.
Why don't you have a wander around starting with that lodge?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Although the Mystery Chapel conversion is on the market for offers above £450,000, it is a substantial proposition. The main house features a cosy living room adjoining a well-equipped modern kitchen, and there is existing planning permission in place to extend the house. What's more, there's one holiday cabin giving them a ready-made income and another with potential. And it's all wrapped up in an acre of gardens and woodlands.
Wow, this is a good size, isn't it?
Yes, yeah. Lovely living room.
Yeah, great kitchen.
A big kitchen, yes, yeah. And they have dining room over there as well. That is really good for renting, yeah.
Yeah, I think this house is a strong contender. There's a few things we need to talk through to discuss, but it's a strong possibility, I believe.
And the downstairs, I love it. Upstairs, we need to see how we can make it work for us.
Yeah, I think the budget that we set you for the requirements that we had was a tough one. I think trying to get all of those elements that we required was perhaps impossible at that price point. But this is an excellent try at that.
What do you think of the grounds?
I think it's quite a big land for us.
What about the slope? Bit of a problem or just careful planting?
Yeah, it could be careful planting.
Hello.
I'm eavesdropping. I can hear you discussing the grounds, which I think could be a good sign what you could do with this garden, but I am going to have to drag you away.
OK.
Our final property. Decisions need to be made. So shall we hit the road and then we can have a proper chat?
OK.
Sounds like a plan.
All right. Yeah.
More and more of us are concerned about the provenance of our food, where it comes from and how it's produced. Across the country, the government has established food enterprise zones, making it easier for food-focused entrepreneurs to fulfil their farming ambitions. Richard and Fiona Harding left financial careers in London to give their children a rural quality of life and to convert their passion for food into farming traditional breeds, raised ethically and sustainably. At Norton Barton Farm, they've established an artisan food village. I've come to meet them to learn more about the village and the food enterprise zones.
So here we are on your farm, and you're part of this exciting new project, this food enterprise zone. What does that mean exactly?
Well, for us, it means an artisan food village. For other people in other areas, it could mean new dairies or diversifications on their farm that allow them to have greater sustainability.
Food enterprise zones provide grants of up to £50,000 to develop high-quality regional produce, and they make it easier for businesses to expand.
So what's the story? How did you get involved?
We wanted to make a better life for our children. We've got four children, and the first one was quite poorly, and it just made us reassess our lives as bankers.
Do I take it you were living in London then?
Bislington at the time.
Ah, OK.
So we decided we would move to Cornwall.
And did you have any experience at all in farming?
No, yes, we listened to the archers.
And that was it?
That's it.
So what happened in those early days?
Well, I'd come in from the office and I'd listen to the archers and they'd be saying, oh, you should be silaging. So I'd ring up a local farmer and say, Philip, should we be silaging? And he'd go, no, boy, leave it a couple of weeks. Sort of, Philip, what is silaging? And so we learned.
Richard and Fiona produce charcuterie, but they hope that their status as a food enterprise zone will make Norton Barton a magnet for other small farmers.
We're hoping to build a collection of artisan producers, bring them all together in one area so that we can share expertise, we can share experience, we can share highs and lows.
So tell me, how do you share the responsibilities?
Well, I handle the business aspects.
And I do the livestock. In fact, we've just had some piglets. Would you like to come and see them?
I would love to. Looking forward to this.
Richard and Fiona farm a variety of animals, including ducks and cattle, but they focus on breeds of pig that are local to Cornwall.
Who do we have here? Oh, look at them. They are so adorable. So what breed are these pigs?
This particular one is a Berkshire Cornish Lop cross, but the one in here is actually a purebred Cornish Lop.
I can tell, Fiona, that you're really hands-on with this farm. It is a labour of love. I mean, you're still running it as a business, but what difference does that mean?
We want to make sure that the life they live is a good life. So we have an organic farm. We rear them to organic principles. They should have access to the outdoors. We have an open house policy. If people come here and they want to see the pigs, they're very welcome. We always let people see that we do what we say we do.
Yeah.
Because I think that's really important. But why don't you go and have a look at Richard in the farm shop?
Thank you.
The shop is where I'll get a taste of other local delicacies from Richard's expanding artisan food village.
Well, it looks impressive. Is this all locally produced?
Yes, everything here we produce on the farm. That's a salami you're trying. So that's a quintessential Cornish salami. It's made with seaweed that's harvested off the Falmouth coast and cider that we have on the farm here.
Mmm, that's really good. How many local producers do you have here?
At the moment, there are five of us producing. There's the cheese, the salamis, the chorizos, the biscuits are made here, cider will be made here, and we've got a still, so we're going to start making rum and apple brandy.
For you, what is the vision? What does the future hold?
We're going to have a chocolatier here, we're going to have a bakery here, we'll have a butchery here. We would like a producer that's making cakes to come and join us, coffee, roasting, educational centre.
Let's toast that then to the future.
Thank you.
And I hope I'm invited back to see all this good work happening.
Oh yes, please come and visit us again.
Well done to you.
Thank you.
And the team. Mmm, that's definitely worth coming back for.
Brilliant.
Well, today's Mystery House certainly got a better reaction than the previous two we showed them yesterday. But has it done enough? I'm not so sure. Time to have a chat with Hannah and Robin and see what they've got to say. Well, Hannah and Robin, I wonder how we got on these last few days.
Yeah, you've shown us some wonderful properties. It's been an education as well, I think, for us.
What have you learnt?
Perhaps that we need to revisit the budget and perhaps reduce the parameters on the size of land so we don't have to compromise on the other bits that we wanted.
Now, there was one house I think you liked more than the others.
Yeah, for me, my favourite was the Mystery House. And could have been made better with some work on our behalf.
Yeah, I think that house is close to what we want to. But again, the land, it just sit there. It do nothing for us because it on the slope.
Quite a steep slope.
Yeah, I can't change that.
You know, I hope all of the properties that we showed you have helped inspire you with this move and given you a taste of perhaps what you can get when you finally move to this beautiful part of the world. So all the best. I take it you're going to keep looking?
Oh, indeed, indeed. Yeah.
Yeah. Get the old calculator out,
crunch
rework the
numbers.
Sums. Have a word about the garden.
Yeah.
And, well, I hope it all goes well and fingers crossed you do find what you're looking for.
Thank you very much, Nikki.
I think you'll agree this has been a rather ambitious house hunt over the last few days in Cornwall. But I feel that Robin and Hannah now realise that in order to achieve their dream, they're going to either have to compromise on the land, something that Hannah wants so desperately, or to crunch the numbers and up their budget. Whatever they decide, we wish them all the very best with their continued search. And I'll see you again soon on Escape to the Country. If you would like to escape to the country in England, Wales, Northern Ireland or Scotland and need our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.